All right, everybody, welcome to this session. Our topic tonight is, do you need God to be a moral person? And we have a speaker representing atheism, or what might also be known as secular humanism. That's Tom Gebhardt. Am I right? A little round of applause for Tom. And we have Pastor Keith Thomas on my left. How about a round for him? Pastor Keith is one of the pastors of this church, and we really appreciate this church opening up this for a place to talk. It's really helpful. It's not that easy to find places. And I thank these two guys for being bold enough to get together and try to air out their ideas. And we're going to have a lot of opportunity for the audience. And I'm glad to see kids here because I like to answer questions from their angle. So we'll see if we can draw some questions from their viewpoint also. We have the brochure here. So each speaker is going to have 10 minutes to give a presentation. Okay, this microphone's on to you, right? Okay. All right, everybody, welcome to this session. Our topic tonight is, do you need God to be a moral person? And we have a speaker representing atheism, or what might also be known as secular humanism. That's Tom Gebhardt. Am I right? A little round of applause for Tom. And we have Pastor Keith Thomas on my left. How about a round for him? Pastor Keith is one of the pastors of this church, and we really appreciate this church opening up this for a place to talk. It's really helpful. It's not that easy to find places. And I thank these two guys for being bold enough to get together and try to air out their ideas. And we're going to have a lot of opportunity for the audience. And I'm glad to see kids here because I like to answer questions from their angle. So we'll see if we can draw some questions from their viewpoint also. We have the brochure here. So each speaker is going to have 10 minutes to give a presentation. And then after that, they're going to have 5 minutes each to hopefully engage in a dialogue. So Tom could ask Keith some pressing matters that he saw from his presentation and vice versa with Keith to Tom. Then we're going to have an audience Q&A for almost an hour, and then we're going to follow up with 2-minute summaries from each. So when we do the question and answer period, I'll give you some guidelines on how to do that. So I'd like to start with Pastor Keith. And again, the question is, do you need God to be a moral person? And Pastor Keith will give his presentation first. And both of these speakers have latitude to kind of take this topic wherever they want to because there's so many sub-themes. So it's kind of up to them. And then when you have a chance, you can add your own themes.
Originally, I'd seen the question on the internet as, can an atheist be a genuinely moral person? So at times, if I state it that way, it's very similar. But that's how I prepared my presentation quite a while ago. I want to thank West Side Science and Religion Discussion Group first for choosing this topic, because most of the topics I see in debate seem to put the Christian on the defensive, on the hot seat. And this time they've chosen one that puts more of Tom in that position. So it was a very admirable, and not even say moral, choice on your part. So thank you. I want to put my cards on the table. I'm a presuppositionalist. I'm not even an apologist, but I subscribe to the school of thought in apologetics known as presuppositionalism. And what that really means is we all have presuppositions. In fact, I'll confess to you that God exists is a presupposition I hold. But it's also true that God does not exist is a presupposition. Neither one can be demonstratively proven. So they both are actually, I don't even feel comfortable calling them articles of faith, belief systems. The question is where each of these belief systems lead us in the topic at hand. First of all, God exists. Well, from a Christian perspective, God exists. Let's define our terms. What is morality, first of all? I'm going to use a sociologist named Christian Smith. I don't know if he's a Christian in spite of his name, but he gets us off to a good start. He says, moral is an orientation toward understanding about what is right and wrong, just and unjust, that are not established by our own actual desires or preferences, but instead are believed to exist apart from them, providing standards by which our desires and preferences can themselves be judged. So the important thing to note about this definition is the absoluteness. to our morality, that there's actually a right and a wrong we believe, and it's not simply relative to our preferences and desires. As we'll see for the Christian, morality is more than that, but it's not less than that. In my own experience, I think we all know this to be true in our heart of hearts. I'm not speaking in our cognitive, intellectual belief system, but rather in our functional belief system. We all know that if you press someone far enough, there are things that are just right and just wrong. I could press you tonight and say, what about genocide? What about Hitler? What about slavery? What about these other things? Are those not just wrong? But you know, I don't have to go that far. I can just say, what about you when you've waited dutifully for a long time to get on the right highway in a long line, and at the last second somebody cuts right in front of you? You say, ooh, they must have different preferences. Or do you think, doggone it, that's just wrong? Well, where does this sense of right and wrong that we all have, where does it come from? The Bible says in Romans 2:14 and 15 that it comes from something God's given us called conscience. And the conscience accuses us of wrong and also excuses us, confirms the right thing. It's like a moral compass within all of us. And in fact, that passage says that non-Christians can obey their conscience. I want to make a reference to John Calvin as well in my argument right now, because not because I'm a Calvinist, I happen to be a Calvinist, but because if there's any branch of Christianity that the atheist would say would discredit the possibility of a non-believer being ethical, it's Calvinism, with its emphasis on total depravity. Now, total depravity is not that we are totally depraved, sinful in every faculty of our life. That's not it. The total refers to the fact that every single faculty in our life is touched by sin. We do have corruption in our intellect, in our will, in our emotions, etc. But even John Calvin tempered this teaching with a teaching on common grace. And common grace says this, that God graciously has allowed the fallen to sin to not be so total that mankind, apart from God, cannot enjoy vestiges of the image of God. So even from Calvinism, I'm going to affirm that yes, atheists can do moral acts and even conform to a moral code at the level we've spoken of so far. But remember, I said to the Christian that morality is not less than this. It's actually more than just the absoluteness. If God exists, he is the creator, he is the author of life, and everything has to do with him. Romans 11:36 says it very succinctly. It says, for from him, and through him, and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Those two go together. If everything is from him, in fact, if our lives, if we're a part of the created order, and we're from him, and we exist to him, that is, we're made to exist relationally with him. Well, if that's true, we ought, a very highly moral word, we ought to glorify him. And as our catechism says, enjoy him forever. One other point about Christian view of morality is we are spiritual beings. We're not just atoms. We're not just matter. And if that's true, our motives are very important to our morality. 1 Corinthians 13 talks about love. And it goes so far as to say, even if I give everything I own, including my body, for a good cause, but I have not love, I gain nothing. So motives are not periphery to morality for the Christian, they're rather central. If love isn't a motive we have, love for neighbor and for God, then that moral act does not hit its intended target, which is to build up our neighbor and to honor God. So, in conclusion, if God exists, then he is the giver and the object of our morality. And although one can do moral acts, he or she cannot be genuinely moral if God is not included in his motives. Now, what about the presupposition God does not exist? Where do we go with that? I want you to imagine with me. There is no heaven, there is no hell, only sky above and earth below. Quoting that great 60s theologian and philosopher John Lennon. There's nothing outside the material world. It is a closed universe. As Marcus Aurelius said almost 2,000 years ago, philosophers said, either there is providence or atoms. That's it. In this case, imagine that it's only atoms. That's all there is. There is no providence. There is no hand behind it. We're just protoplasm, evolved through random mutations in order to survive. We're nothing more than matter, no different than any other form of life. If this be the case, there is no ultimate meaning in life. And what is right If we live in a closed universe of only matter, who has the right to raise his material head and declare what is right and what is wrong? And if two material heads, be it persons, governments, societies, differ, how can we know who is right and who is wrong? No matter which answer we put forth from the atheist camp, be it the individual, innate human solidarity, evolved morality, there rings back the question, says who? I'd like to close my time quoting Arthur Leth, an agnostic himself who was a professor of law. He was an agnostic, I remind you. Professor of law, he says, when would it be impermissible to make the formal intellectual equivalent of what is known in schoolyards as the grand says who? In the absence of God, each ethical system will be differentiated by the answer it chooses to give to one key question. Who among us ought to be able to declare law that ought to be obeyed? Stated that baldly, the question is so intellectually unsettling that one would expect to find a noticeable number of ethical thinkers trying not to come to grips with it. Either God exists or he does not. And if he does not, nothing and no one can take his place in saying what's moral. As things stand now, everything is up for grabs. Nevertheless, napalming babies is bad. Starving the poor is wicked. Buying and selling each other is depraved. There is in the world such a thing as evil. All together now, says who? God help us. End of quote. It is a fine question that your fellow unbeliever raises, Tom. If we are but an accidental allocation of atoms, words of Bertrand Russell, at the end of the day, what is right and what is wrong? And says who? Nietzsche was right. If God is dead, any and all morality is baseless. And if Nietzsche is right, then asking if an atheist can be genuinely moral is like asking if a person can really be put on Santa's naughty list. If there's no such thing as morality, the question of an atheist being moral is irrelevant.
I'm not sure you have another minute if you want. Pastor Keith and Mr. Tom Gebhardt.
Easy reading material on the subject of evolutionary morality is not not easy to come by. Scientists aren't exactly great writers. So those of you here who want to read more, I suggest Primates and Philosophers, How Morality Evolved by Francie Wahl, and The Science of Good and Evil by Michael Shermer. I can give those two book titles at the end of the event for those who want to look into those. Michael Shermer, in his book, The Science of Good and Evil, argued that the moral sense evolved within us because we are a social primate species, and we need to get along with one another. And therefore, we are pro-social, cooperative, and even altruistic at times. And not altruistic in a game theory, tit-for-tat, calculating way in which I help you and you owe me, but in a deeper, genuine sense of feeling good, actually feeling good about helping others. So those are two books I recommend for anyone who can get, that anyone here can get through. But again, they won't give you detailed arguments, and instead the basic concepts and ideas. A main point here, to go against what we know and feel is ethical is to go against our nature. This brings up the topic of consequentialism. A basic definition of consequentialism, which is one of the key areas in my secular humanist ethical worldview, is that the consequences of one's conduct are the main and ultimate basis for any judgment about the rightness of that conduct, of those actions. Thus, from a consequentialist standpoint, a morally right act is one that will produce a good outcome or consequence. Moving on to a different angle here, where you can ask tonight's question from the position of a non-believer. Does disbelieving in God encourage people to be less moral, and does it strike at the heart of being genuinely moral? I personally don't feel non-belief as this weight that pulls at my morality in a downward spiral. Also, non-belief in God and in Him being the source of my morality, a non-belief in that, or the lack of a belief in an absolute moral standard, doesn't leave the morality that I live day to day feeling hollow and artificial. But here's a major question, maybe the biggest question many of you really want to know from, like, an atheist tonight. Is, formally put, does moral nihilism logically follow from a morality with no reference to or source of God, no transcendent absolute meaning? Friedrich Nietzsche is credited a lot with the concept of nihilism. And a quote from him, he defined nihilism as emptying the world, and especially human existence, of meaning, purpose, comprehensible truth, or essential value. And he's quoted as saying, when we find out that the world does not possess the objective value or meaning we want it to have, or have long since believed it to have, we find ourselves in a crisis. There is something to be said about this. I was raised in Christianity, when I was, to believe the world possessed objective value and meaning. As I moved away from Christianity and the faith over the years, there was a disillusioning process where the evidence I studied made me come to the conclusion such as there's no evidence for God, no intelligent design in this life, only one life to live, and when it's over, no heaven, no afterlife. Things in evolution, such as 99% of all species that have ever lived have gone extinct. Humans are not the center of the universe. No ultimate source to our morality, only human nature determined by evolution. That if there is a design and purpose in the world, it is the survival of the fittest and natural selection. So if there is no ultimate meaning or direction in the reality, in this reality that we live in, why should one be moral and make this life as we live in as meaningful as possible? A real answer to this is that because we are hardwired to find meaning, and to not make meaning in our lives would be to go against the psychology of our minds as determined by our brains. In other words, to do this would be to go against our nature. But one might argue, but it's also our nature to hurt others, to steal, to even take life, especially when we feel our life and survival being threatened, to which I would respond, you're absolutely right. Compassion and violence are neurological predispositions that we all have. It's also interesting that both compassion and violence have an evolutionary survival value to them. Our compassion helps us to survive because together is better than being alone. When we share, the other reciprocates and there becomes a relationship. The more this sharing happens, the greater the number of participants, and so there becomes strength and safety in numbers, ensuring a greater survival of those in that group. This is how clans, tribes, and ultimately civilizations started. Our flight or fight response is also there for when there's no reciprocation, no sharing. When there is no relationship but one species trying to dominate or destroy for resources, etc., the other. The evolutionary logic and instinct is simple, kill or be killed. And this need to survive is probably our deepest instinct, even deeper than altruism, possibly. Cooperation, sharing in groups. So I'm being honest with you as an atheist and not telling you exactly what you want to hear. So it is important to realize that there is probably that moral nihilism does logically follow with non-belief in God and no ultimate meaning in the world. And for one who's looking at that, to indeed go down the path of disillusionment that I took. But just because it logically follows doesn't mean we have to live that way. There is also the obligation to stay true to our psychological nature, our mental state. In other words, that we are hardwired to find patterns, to make meaning in our daily lives, and to make our lives significant. We also have the instinct to be happy, possibly as deep as our instinct to survive. And this is why we make meaning in our lives. How much time do we have?
About almost 2 minutes.
Okay. So, you know, I look forward to other things that
will
be...
1 minute.
1 minute.
Yeah.
Okay. I look forward to other things that will definitely be brought up because it's in tonight. Because as Keith said and Bernie said, it is a complicated topic. There's lots of subtopics that we can go off to, like consequentialism, moral relativism. I brought up nihilism, moral nihilism, and I know I didn't introduce exactly what my secular humanistic ethical worldview is made up of. But two main components to think about as we go into this event tonight. For me, it's consequentialism and utilitarianism, which means to pursue your own pleasure and happiness in as much as it does not hinder the pleasure and happiness of others. And to me, I hold that view of morality very dearly. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so for this next little section, I'm going to try to explain this because it hasn't really worked out too well, I think, in the past. Here's what I'm trying to accomplish. Each person will have 5 minutes, and for example, we're going to start with Keith because he hasn't had a chance to talk recently. We'll give Tom a little chance to rest his voice. So for Keith, he'll have 5 minutes, and I'd like him to ask Tom a question about his presentation, maybe something that he thought was really lacking, or just anything, maybe something you brought up and you thought maybe he needs to address. And I would like you to not lecture, but try to have a conversation with him, but you're in the driver's seat. And Tom, I don't want you to try to answer the question with a lecture either. So hopefully you have a discussion where which you're driving for 5 minutes, and then we'll switch it around where he can drive a question.
Okay.
Okay, so let's try that.
Do you have eye contact there? Between
yeah,
each
could
other?
You move that pole there?
Tom, just to clarify, I want to see if I've captured you well. I'm trying to make a statement here of what I heard you say. Make sure I'm not misinterpreting you. There's absolutely no meaning to life, nor is there true morality, but we do have a psychological nature that falsely believes that there is. So we're obligated to follow, we're morally obligated to follow that psychological nature. and we can thus be genuinely moral. Is that what you said?
Small yes and a medium no. A lot of what it was kind of correct. We don't feel like there's an ultimate meaning to life and a transcendent, absolute morality. And our, you could say that our psychological minds falsely presume that there is. but it's just kind of a strange word to use falsely. So other than that, sounds pretty close.
Okay. I found it very interesting, your use of the word obligated. There's no ultimate meaning or direction in this reality we live in. But we're obligated, and so you're saying moral nihilism does lead down that road, but we're obligated to follow this psychological nature that says we should be happy. If there's no morality, why are we obligated to do that? Says who?
I don't remember where I said obligated, but I'll just assume that I did. Maybe a better word is that we have a predisposition. We have a compellment. We are driven to want to find meaning. That speaks to the resilience of human nature, you could say.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, but we should follow that?
Well, should is a very interesting word, should or could. But, I mean, if it's instinctive and it's in our nature, the should really isn't there as much as that is what we do. It is a part of who we are. Just like we don't think about breathing, we're not compelled or make decisions to breathe. It is just a part of who we are. And I feel personally that morality is basically on that level. Like I said, it's a very, very deep evolutionary instinct in us. It's as deep as survival.
Evolution doesn't hide the fact that we have a predator nature as well. Are we obligated, or should we follow that as well? Stay true to it?
that's a very good point. That brings up something I could add about myself. Just because I'm an atheist, that doesn't mean that that's all I need to think about. That's the only worldview I need to have. Atheism is just a choice to not believe. The question now is, how now ought I to live my life? And for me, it's as a secular humanist. And a major element in my secular humanism is utilitarianism, which answers your question, that if I'm going to pursue my own pleasure and happiness, inasmuch as it doesn't hinder or harm the pleasure of happiness of others, then I need to keep that, if I have that value, that standard, that part of my ethical worldview, then to pursue the primal nature, you know, the violent evolutionary side that is in all of us, is to go against those values, is to go against my consciousness, and I will ultimately not be happy with that. That is, if I have a healthy, normal mind.
Okay. You also mentioned consequences determine morality. I would consider there's many good consequences, like birth would be a very good consequence. Would that justify rape?
Again, it's a very simple ethical standard. It's not a rape wouldn't be justified in that situation. It's just, I don't know, it's just very straightforward in my mind, because it's one person hindering, and definitely in this situation, harming another person. So the ends, maybe that's what you might be getting at. The ends do not justify the means, and vice versa.
Yeah, that's 5 minutes. Is that a good ending, or?
If it's at five, that's five minutes. That's 5 minutes. That's okay. Yeah.
All right. Okay, Tom. Remember, you're in the driver's seat, and we'd like to see a dialogue. So try to go back and forth. No lectures on a question or answer.
Don't take 5 minutes to answer first question.
let's see. Very good presentation, by the way.
Thank you, Tom.
I noticed that you, bringing up scripture is a very important foundation to the presentation that you gave tonight. So, for me to get to know you a little bit better, for example, Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, the fruits of the Spirit. Do you believe that you have a love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, what it says in that scripture, that is on a different level than other people because who don't have this, the Holy Spirit, because that is the fruit of the Spirit in your life?
Yeah, I do believe that God's producing that. It's maybe not as simple as that. In Christianity, we believe in sanctification. It's fairly messy. I do feel that God's forgiven my sins because Christ died for them, but that didn't become totally holy at that moment. But I do feel like God's Holy Spirit is working those things in me. It could be that I could be behind on at least some moral ethical things, some other people, even maybe non-believers, because I started so far behind. Maybe I was just an absolute wreck in my life when I started. But I feel like whether you're a wreck or whether you're at wherever you're found by God, I do feel like, yes, there is a growth process in life that God puts Christians on. Yeah.
It says in the New Testament to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Mm-hmm. I know that a major important part of the Christian's relationship to God is love. It also seems that fear and reverence, a fear of punishment, is that a significant aspect of your Christianity and motivating you?
And the other thing is try to stick to the topic. So generally speaking, we're about morality. So it wouldn't be appropriate to say, well, what about Noah's Ark, you know, for example? That's, you know, totally off the topic here. So let's try to keep the topic. After the event, people will stick around and talk so we can talk about all these other issues that are in the background. So with that, we'll start. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4 microphones. You can come up and ask a question now. And I notice we have quite a few kids in the audience too, so I'd really like to encourage them and give them a preference too. So whoever has a question, just go to a microphone and we'll just go 1, 2, 3, 4. So
first we'll hear this question.
Yeah. Right. And then you can queue up now if you want to for the next question anywhere you want to.
So I would like to address the says who question. Says who that the Bible is the book we have to look to as speaking for God. From my point of view, that's just people giving their morality, they attribute it to a deity to make it more enforceable. But how do you arrive from there is a God that which is the absolute morality to the Bible is the book that gives the morality and speaks for God?
Question,
was that me?
Yes.
Well, I would first of all note that that is beyond the range of our debate tonight. I don't have to answer it. The question tonight for the first time puts the atheist on the hot seat to defend why an atheist can be a genuine moral person. So it is beyond the range of saying that, but I would say this, just by trying to at least engage someone in the question. I do have a presupposition that God exists. I admit that. I think the atheist should admit the same. They can't prove God doesn't exist. If God does exist, it is perfectly reasonable to think that he would be able to manifest himself to his society, to his people. And so a big God, if he does exist, would not have a problem revealing himself. And it is a different epistemology. Yeah, I do believe in revelation. And I don't mind confessing that.
Let me just interject here. We didn't really speak about this amongst ourselves, really, but okay, my personal opinion is, number one, the speakers can answer the question however they want to answer it, but my preference is that if it looks like it has any kind of relationship to morality, it's an okay question. So, I mean, this, you know, you don't have to answer if you don't want to, but my preference would be if it looks like it's halfway into it, you know, I would hope people answer.
My two cents that would kind of complement what Bernie is trying to say is that, just let's remember, morality is can be a very complicated topic, and there are a lot of subtopics to it. And I'm assuming that what you're maybe trying to get at is the Bible is a guidebook. It's for living And a lot of Christians use the Bible to guide or inform their morality, so that would be an example where there might be some connection to that.
And if I could just say, I just think that the Christian experience, that there is right and wrong, points most clearly to the fact that there is some source of right and wrong, and I think we all do, deep down inside, feel there's a right and wrong, so we have to account for that. If it's a closed universe, I don't see any other alternative than moral nihilism, which I just don't think explains our experience very well. I think Revelation actually explains our experience much more clearly and accurately than does moral nihilism.
Did you want to respond to this, or are you okay?
No, I apologize. I went on topic to you, but it just seemed like it was a main part of what you said, is that if you don't believe in God, it gets to the says who. To me, the says who exists anyway. Even if you
hear
the religion, it still is the says who, that religion is the guidepost for the answer.
Okay, well, that's fair. That didn't have to do. I see that more clearly. Now you were connecting it to my lecture, sir.
Okay, question over here. Go ahead.
You might say that this might be a little off the topic, but it relates to something Thomas said. It made me wonder, and I'm just paraphrasing this in my own words, that it seems like Thomas, you said something about, since it's human nature, due to our genetic makeup and our evolution, for us to look for patterns of meaning in life, that it's appropriate then for us to make a meaning or find meaning, even though there is no ultimate meaning. But my question is, well, if that's the case, that it's our human nature and therefore it's appropriate, well, it's also, a lot of times even evolutionists say it's human nature to look for agency as the cause behind things. And the many people, that leads them to believe in God as the source of it. So would it be appropriate or wise for them to believe in God then, because it's their human nature to look for agency?
That's a great question. Yeah, there's, I guess you could say, this is where the phrase, two sides of every coin, or, you know, sword has two edges to it. I guess the consequences of seeking meaning is that you may look for logical, objective meaning in the world, or you may connect certain dots and find more of a transcendent. It's just meaning. We just can't underestimate how advanced our pattern recognition ability is. We can see images in the clouds. We find things where there might not be things, especially when you add stress and the pressures of life. Those things can put a person in sort of a pressure cooker type of situation where there's a desperate need, longing for some type of answer, even though there might not be, because that person wants relief, they want hope. And that's fine, that's what it means to be human. It seems like some people, a lot of people, will then seek God by that very actual, the way that we're designed. Where other people will go, there is no God, because the evidence that I'm looking at, that the accumulation of evidence, says not. So it's a very interesting question, why some people go this way with that way we're designed and other people go this way. Do you have a thought on that, David?
Colin? Next question.
Yes, Pastor Thomas, your opening remarks I thought were kind of ironic. You mentioned that morality is things like slavery are bad, genocide are bad. How do you explain that the Bible is just full of references that God seems to approve and even instigates genocide and slavery and many, many other, what we would call immoral acts?
Okay. Yeah, that's a good question. First of all, I would say that there are times in history that God has pronounced judgment upon peoples, and there are times in which God, as God, has made a decision. And even if we look, Israel was forbidden to go into Canaan for a long time in order to give more time to the inhabitants. But I don't deny that, according to the Bible, it seems like there's points at which God says enough of this, and there are temporary judgments that do happen on earth. I think it's different for God to make a judgment in his sovereign wisdom and for man to take to put himself in the position of God and to begin to do that. And I mean, I've had a problem with the church in the past when they've taken up the sword. The church is not to take up the sword. That's usurp something that God's given to the state. But yeah, and as far as slavery, you see a very, very different kind of slavery in the Old Testament. It was a Jewish person who had hit destitution, who could, he had no other means, he could sell himself into slavery until he could work himself out of that situation. So I don't have a problem with that. I think that there's times when someone hit destitution, they had a means within the society in which they could sell themselves and work themselves out and regain their inherited property.
I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about when you capture a slave, when you capture a prisoner, you make him your slave. Or
can you show me the scriptures where that happens?
Oh, sure.
I just checked the cameras on you.
Leviticus 25:24. Well, that's one. Exodus 21:7. A man sells his daughter to slaves, you will not go out as a male slave to do.
What now, what's it say?
You mean a man sells his daughter as a slave?
Yes. What's your point? Go ahead.
Well,
could you read the whole verse? It described a reality. It didn't prescribe anything. Could you read the verse? I heard no prescription. I heard a description. Could you read it again?
I'm reading the scripture. A man sells his daughter as a slave, she shall not go out as the male slaves do. If she does not please her master, but has designated her for himself, then she shall be, let her be redeemed. Mm-hmm. So I think, if you buy a slave to be like your teacher, if he doesn't like her, you can let her go.
No, it's talking about the seller. Yeah, and it could be simply prescribing within the system a certain protection for that particular girl who was sold. It wasn't prescribing, it was describing a reality that happened, and then it provided a protection for that girl who was sold. And we certainly see in Scripture, one of the things people misunderstand about Scripture is there is a progression in the Scriptures. God in His mercy did not just come upon mankind and said, all these sins are bad, so you're all wiped out. There's a tremendous amount of tolerance throughout the Old Testament of things that we see become much more clear with time. For example, polygamy is a part of the Old Testament. It describes that. It doesn't prescribe it. But it is, several things like slavery and polygamy are described. But we see them disappearing in the Scriptures. We see a progression through the Scriptures to where we understand that it was a one man made for one wife by the time we get to the New Testament. And what's very interesting is slavery has disappeared where Christianity has grown most. Slavery still exists in the world, but where Christianity has grown most, slavery has disappeared. And so if we take the Bible as just a flat book, it is confusing. But if you do read it, understanding that God is mercifully revealing himself in a progressive unfolding type of manner, we do see a certain morality that eliminates some of the things that he permitted that are not permitted in the New Testament but were permitted for a time.
How is it moral for God to kill all the firstborn in Egypt? Women, children, babies, unborn babies, so that's in effect.
Yeah, you'd have to read the story, the whole thing, if you want to do that. But I would say this, the Egyptians held the Israelites in bondage for a long time, and God came and said, let my children go. And they were his children, and they didn't let them go. And he gave them warning after warning, plague after plague, and Egypt would not respond in kind. And so basically God says, you will not let my children go, you will lose your firstborn. And I think God has the right to pronounce the judgments over his creation that he's made. I think that's God's prerogative, and I feel like in this case, they had plenty of warning, and they didn't take the warning. They hardened their hearts, they turned away from the warnings, and they reaped a judgment for that.
Hold on. So what we're going to do here is, Tom has a response, and then we'll ask Keith if he has a response to that, and we're going to move on to other questions. Thanks for your question. Tom?
Thank you, Carol, for your questions. Two points here that came to mind as you had the exchange. One, I guess since you went into a biblical commentary and context, I'll give quick commentary on that. A interesting conclusion I have is that it seems like if the Bible needs really deep context and commentary so that we can do justice to scriptures, to not underestimate the complexity of scriptures. And you have a biblical scholar who's done 10 years on a passage and a biblical scholar who's done 10 years on this passage, ultimately coming to disagreements on this. I would argue that then the Bible should not be for the average common person, because we don't want to misunderstand the Bible, and even worse, lead people astray by quoting scriptures and our understanding of scriptures. So I would consider that, in all respect, an unintelligent design of the Bible. The second point here real quick is not to address Carol's points, but to address the very fact that Carol has conviction about some of the things that he sees in the Bible. There's an injustice, a conviction there, an indignation about some of the things. And so that goes back to the main topic of this question of tonight. Do you need God to be a genuinely moral person? Well, right here, Carol is a non-believer, and he's showing conviction about certain ethical things he sees in the Bible, whether or not he's interpreting them correctly. He has conviction about those things being wrong. And so that's a very nice example of what I'm trying to share tonight.
Okay, Pastor Keith, can you maybe a short response and then move on to the other question?
Well, I think I always am just amazed at moral nihilism is, and you've even said it, it's the truth. I mean, if you embrace evolution, it really is logical. You shouldn't embrace the implications, but it is true. It's logical, moral nihilism. But there is not a moral nihilist in this group, I don't think. And the fact that you're here to debate means you believe there is some truth or falsity on the line. If you really believe that there's no truth, no falsity, what are you doing here? Just go out and eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow and die. I always think debates are one of the highest evidences that we all do sense that there is a right and there is a wrong.
Okay, I think Tom has a response. Maybe you can work that in during another question, or just maybe a quick one.
For something we can address later, maybe after the thing. In my presentation, I didn't say that moral nihilism is the way to go, but that it is simply a something that logically follows. It is a conclusion that one can come to, but that we have a nature, a biological predisposition to want to find meaning in our lives, and to go against that would actually be to go against our nature. We ultimately wouldn't be happy.
Okay, so now we're going to try to speed this up a little bit, because we have like 5 questions already queued up. So for the answers, let's see if we can keep them a little bit shorter. So let's go, where do you think we can go like this? 1, 2, 3, 4, and we have another one over here. So let's start over here. Go ahead.
Thank you. My question is for Tom. I'm sorry if this is out of the question or if it's still in the question, but how can there be morality without God? Like in Genesis 1, for example, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Now pretend that the word God was out of the verse. How could there be morality without him if he like created the universe or something like that?
Well, I appreciate your honesty, and I can tell that your relationship with God, I'm assuming you're a Christian.
Yes, I've been baptized last week.
Very nice. that you're very sincere about your relationship with God, and that you have conviction. You feel that your relationship with God is actually not just informing your morality, but keeping you on a straight, narrow path. Would you say that's correct? Or?
I would say that is correct.
And so I'm not here to say that you're wrong or disillusional. It's a fact that you feel strongly about your Christianity. And so that's why this is such a sensitive topic, because a lot of Christians really feel that their morality and their relationship with God go hand in hand. I have a testimony that I can share after the event if you'd like to hear it, how over the years, reluctantly, in the same way that C.S. Lewis reluctantly moved from atheism to Christianity, I over the years moved reluctantly from Christianity to atheism, because my mind was encountering information that I couldn't deny, that information, that knowledge had implications ramifications to it that affected my faith. So I know that it probably doesn't make any sense to you why I wouldn't want God. So that's a great question.
Okay, but is it possible to like, give me an answer, or?
He did.
Okay. Anyway,
so the way you read it was kind of interesting. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So imagine, he sees God create the heavens and the earth. So it's like, if there's no God, how can you have morality? It's just, that's kind of what you're saying, right? You're just.
Yes, that's it. That's about exactly what I was trying to say. If there's no God, how could there be morality? Or, how could we be here?
Well, one could also ask, again, good question. Why and how do we do the things that we do? Do we understand our bodies well enough? Do we understand our minds well enough? And the answer is no. These are very complicated and deep things. And so it's a very good question for one to ask. If you don't think there's a God, how can you think that there's morality? Because God is the source of morality. So I understand how you're logically trying to address that. But because I went down a road that I got my nose into books outside of the Bible and I read into science and philosophy, I came to some conclusions that showed me that it's more complicated than that. And I know that's not a very satisfying answer for you, but that is an answer that I've come to. It's very complicated, and it'd be nice if it were cut and dry and black and white like that.
All right, okay, Pastor Keith, you want to give us just a short response so we can move on to another question? Okay.
All right, thank you.
Thank you for your question.
Okay, this question is addressed to Tom. My 22-year-old son had planned to be here tonight. Unfortunately, he couldn't make it because he killed himself 3 weeks ago. Tom, speak to the issue of morality of suicide from the perspective of the secular humanist, atheist, and those who think we are merely machines or a bunch of random protoplasm.
First of all, I'm very sorry for your loss.
Are people sorry who think we're just machines?
The secular humanist would look at why the body, why the mind does what it does. And one of the things is, way to look at it is, under certain pressures and stresses, we're capable of doing beautiful and wonderful things. But under certain pressures and stresses, situations, we do things that we would otherwise not imagine ourselves doing. There's just all kinds of things in the world, such as depression, Alzheimer's, stress, that affect a person and make them not do what they would otherwise not do. And that's pretty much my answer to your question.
Okay, without God in one's life, okay, my son wanted to kill himself, and he did. I want to kill myself right now. From a secular humanist point of view, what's stopping you? You did say, pursue your own pleasure, your instinct to be happy. If being dead right now would make me happy, what's stopping me?
Great question. A difference between how I am now and how I was as a Christian is I feel like I'm a lot more focused on the moments of life. Because I know that there's one life to live, life becomes incalculably precious. The moments of life, I don't go, there's a heaven that I can look forward to, a second chance, in all respect, you could say. It's about the moments of life,
But that's your view, and
right.
That's your relativistic view. So if you have all these happy moments to life and you think you should live each precious moment, that's your view. What if I say, I don't like life, I don't think these precious moments are special, I want to die. What's stopping me with the secular humanist point of view.
And maybe to a more general way of saying this is like, well, you know, let's say you're a Christian and you say, well, if I don't believe in God anymore, I'm an atheist, I can do whatever I want to. Mm-hmm. I don't have to ever answer to God for this. I'm going to go out and rob stores and be wild and take drugs, and because nobody's going to hold me accountable for all this ultimately. Is that kind of along the same line?
Well, another thing is that another difference between how I was as a Christian and how I am now is that I think a lot more about the people that come after me, my descendants, how I live my life, how is that going to help my kids that come after me. I used to not think about the people that came after me,
and
my descendants.
Your choice to think about as whatever your belief system is.
Right.
You're telling me it's a relative thing. Maybe I don't care about that.
And so I'd have to get to know you better and try to understand exactly your situation. When I was a Christian, I would very conveniently give people quick and short and easy answers, but there's no quick and short and easy answer to your situation. That's one of the things I've come to respect about life, is that it's very complicated. We shouldn't do justice to just giving a straightforward answer, or even quoting scriptures out of the Bible to someone who's going through a divorce or is going through the death of a... who's recovering from the death of a loved one, because it's complicated and it's personal. And I feel like I respect that a lot more now.
Okay, Pastor Pete, did you want to add something quickly?
I was just going to say, I mean, I think when we do grasp moral nihilism and nihilism in general, that life really has absolutely no meaning. And even if I'm quoting from your blog here, I think, Tom, you said it, it's intellectual integrity to acknowledge the conclusion of moral nihilism, to indeed go down that path of disillusionment it takes you, but don't live according to its implications. But people who have gone down that road, Nitschke died going crazy. And I don't see any way around that. I really don't. I mean, except saying, well, we also have a nature that wants to make us happy. Even though you know rationally nihilism makes sense within our framework of belief, don't go there. Don't follow its implications. Shut that off and obey, or you're obligated to go with this your happy gene or whatever it is that makes you want to be happy. But I don't see why we should do that and not go with any other number of... I don't see why we should. If we take our own nihilism back into account and say, well, why should we follow that? There's just no reason to. I can just see that where Nitschke was led by it and what Barbara's getting at, I think, is a natural conclusion that it's hard to avoid. That if life has no meaning, morality doesn't either.
Are you saying that Nietzsche's conclusions led him ultimately to madness and insanity?
Yes.
This is an example of how it's more complicated than that. I believe it was actually just a mental illness. There's a lot of, you could say, believers who have mental illnesses at the end of their lives that go into that same direction. So I respectfully disagree with that conclusion.
Well, you acknowledged in your blog, you said Nitschke states that nihilism as absolute valueless or nothing has meaning is dangerous, or even the danger of danger. It is through valuation that people survive and endure the danger. The complete destruction of all meaning and all values would lead to an existence of apathy and stillness, where positive actions, affirmative actions, will be replaced by a state of reaction and destruction. You're quoting Nitschke there.
I also quoted him from a source, but there's more context than just those particular sources. He said that of course, don't let these conclusions destroy you, but just acknowledge the hard reality that if without meaning and ultimate...
So you need a crutch. Source. It sounds like you need a crutch not to follow that.
Okay, let's have it. Just, you want to do a last, if you wrap up, and we'll go on to another question. Okay.